Hello, I'm Dr. Mikey Mewborn, and this is Systematic Theology 1. Today we're looking at the topic, the doctrine of humanity. It's good to be with you today. This is a wonderful topic because we're looking at who or what is mankind. I love what the psalmist says in Psalm 8:4, "What is man that you are mindful of him?" It's talking about creation there. Now, we know that the Bible tells us that mankind in Genesis chapter 1, 26, 27, we know that the Bible says that man was made in the image of God. But what does that actually mean? And so for the next few lessons, we're going to look at the doctrine of mankind or humanity. What is man? What does it matter? Why is mankind so unique? Why is mankind so special in relation to all the other animals and all the other created things that are on the earth? And so why is this so special? Why are we so special? So we're going to look at those types of things today and for the next couple of days. It's good to be with you today. God bless you, and let's get started. Hello, and welcome to Systematic Theology 1. Today we're looking at the topic, the doctrine of humanity. We're getting our outline notes from Millard Erickson's book, Christian Theology. So good to be with you. Let's go ahead and begin our study. As we look at the doctrine of humanity, I want to start by looking at the importance of the doctrine. Number one, and there will be five of these reasons, but number one, this doctrine is important because of its relation to other Christian doctrines. God is inextricably linked to his creation. We see this in Genesis 1, 26, 27. Then God said, "Let us make man in our image, after our likeness, and let them have dominion over the fish of the sea, and over the birds of the heavens, and over the livestock, and over all the earth, and over every creeping thing that creeps on the earth." So God created man in his own image. In the image of God, he created him. Male and female, he created them. Of course, this passage is so well known to those who are Christians because it speaks of the Creator God, Elohim, creating mankind in his image. And so for the next few lessons, we're going to look at this idea of being created in the image of God. Erickson also said, "If God had not created humans, there would presumably have been no incarnation, no atonement, no need for regeneration and justification. There would have been no church." So we have to see here that within the hypostatic union of Jesus Christ, that he is fully God, but he is also fully human. And he had to be 100% God in order to come to the earth as he did. Of course, to have all dominion, all power, to be in control of all things. But also he had to be fully man or 100% man so that he could die as a sacrificial atonement for humans and for sinners, as we know. So this is vital to his to us understanding humanity. We understand Jesus Christ in the same way, that he had to be fully human. Wonderful topic there to look at. As we continue on, we see number two, the doctrine of humanity is a point where biblical revelation and human concerns converge. Paul Tillich says this, "There's a method of correlation," and he's going to talk about dealing with this idea of how to explain theology to someone where and showing how there's a correlation between humankind and why do we need theology. He begins by asking the question, what is most important to any one person? So he begins with the idea of what's the need, what's the very thing that is needed for life, for people, and so he'll begin with that. And then theology responds by answering the greatest questions within culture. So the idea of theology, the teaching of theology, of course, biblical doctrines, will be the way of responding to these great questions within a culture. And theology is expressed from within a context, not from without. In other words, it's not this this type of external push coming inside. Instead, it's starting with the person, saying there's a need inside, and so based on that need, there is a hunger for some kind of fulfillment of that need, and theology is readily available for someone to get that. And that's his method of correlation, which is kind of interesting. It's almost as in an inductive Bible study or an inductive response to mankind saying that there is a God. You kind of start with the struggle first and then going from there into the answer to that issue, which is a wonderful approach, especially for postmodernism or living in a postmodern world, a wonderful approach to explaining how there is, how human concerns, biblical revelations, those things converge. I think it's a great way to look at it. Also, the importance of the doctrine of humanity, we see evangelism explosion outline. And I wanted to show you this. If you've ever become familiar with evangelism explosion, then there's an outline that you've probably seen, and it goes like this. You first begin by sharing the gospel with somebody and talking about grace, that heaven is a free gift. It is something that God has given. For the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life, and God wants to give eternal life to all those who believe. And so heaven is amazing. You talk about heaven. The next thing is man. Talk about mankind in general. What is man? And then explaining that man is a sinner and those types of things. And this is this push toward pushing people toward evangelism and showing them not just grace or the goodness, the gifts of God, but then understanding man. Then you see who God is and that God must punish sin and that God is a good God. And God extends his grace to so many people, but he also must uphold his justice. And so he took care of our sin on the cross of the person Jesus Christ. And then we have belief through faith in the work of Jesus Christ. But the focus there is that you kind of begin with a need that man has. The need is that man can't get to heaven on his own. He might want to. He might want to be in a place that he loves, but he can't get there. So that's his problem. He's broken. He's a sinner. He's in need of a savior. And so that's the whole idea of evangelism explosion. And it's very similar to the method of correlation that we looked at previously. So kind of interesting, interesting connection there as well. Number three, the doctrine of humanity is significant in the 21st century because of the large amount of attention given to humanity by the various intellectual disciplines. I thought this is very interesting. Based on Erickson's book, behavioral sciences is a growing study within higher education. There's a lot of reasons for this, but people want to know how people behave and why they behave. And so studies on social sciences and the idea of human behavior in general is becoming more and more popular. People want to know why they act as they do in groups. And so with all of the networking going on and the and such as social media type of networking, there's a lot more data to understand how people work and how they function, and people now gathering this data because it's helping to win campaigns and helping them to market more and to make more money. And so people want to know about this. They're willing to pay big dollars so that they can get information. And it's becoming a legal battle as well, because if someone can get into your Twitter feed or your Facebook feed and what they're wanting to do is kind of sell things to you or to find out what you like and then maybe drive campaign people toward you or to get you to believe a certain way, they're working toward those things. So the whole idea of behavioral sciences it's big business these days. And so so this is why number three, we're looking at, there's a lot more attention given to these things. Business and marketing schools are seeking to understand human tendencies. They want to know them more and more because there's a lot of money tied to that. And then medical schools are seeking to treat human beings, not illnesses, diseases, and disorders. There's a big push in the medical field toward this, treating the human being. Of course, you can do that through diet and exercise, things like that, but they want to find out what's going on. A new field, and it's not new, but it's a rising field, of course, in the world of practical or family practice, but it's the idea of the nurse practitioner. Nurse practitioners are fascinating because their whole purpose is to look at a person from a holistic perspective and to say, okay, what are they doing, to ask a lot of questions. And so it's an interesting a philosophy that nurse practitioners have, maybe as opposed to some physicians that would come in and say, what's the issue? Let's see how medicine can apply to those things and really make a huge difference. But a philosophy with a nurse practitioner might see it from a holistic perspective and a little bit differently. And so it's a different type of philosophy, which I think is kind of fascinating because they're both needed. But seeing how it works, it really matters. And I think this is neat as medical schools and different type of nursing schools are looking into this as becoming a bigger deal than it once was. They don't just treat illnesses or diseases, but they actually are treating people. I think that's fascinating. All right, number four, the doctrine of humanity is important because of the present crisis in human self-understanding. Traditional values have become suspect in recent years. People have questioned the reason for their existence. People have questioned the extent of their interaction with one another. People have questioned their physical appearance as well as mental and emotional capabilities. And so when we're thinking about this, people are trying to understand themselves more. They want to know what's driving them. They want to know where these values come from. And so they're looking into these things. And I think that's a great question. Where does morality come from? If you think about this, why do we choose the difference between right and wrong? How do we know what's right and wrong? And it's not something we just know, but it's something that's almost intrinsic. It's inside of us. And you could say, why does a lie detector test work? Well, you could cheat a lie detector test, but you'd have to cheat it. You'd have to learn how to beat that and control your emotions and control how you feel inside, and that would take a lot of time to do that. But the whole idea there is that the lie detector test is showing you if you want to lie or if you don't want to lie. Your body goes through a change when you're trying to lie because it doesn't. It's showing showing you that there's some kind of moral compass, and that your body is letting you know, hey, you're saying something wrong, and you know that it's wrong. I think that's amazing and fascinating when you think about morality in general. And the study of it is just as fascinating. Number five, the doctrine of humanity affects how we minister. When we think about what we know about humanity, it definitely affects how we minister to people. Humans have many characteristics and needs. Think about the emotional, the physical, the mental, the spiritual. There's so many ways that people need help or they need ministering to. And you can think of emotional needs, physical, mental, definitely spiritual. But in all these ways, we're called to help people. And the Bible speaks of this, whether it's somebody that is in need of clothing, somebody that's in need of food, somebody that's in need of some form of maybe protection, whatever it might be. Somebody needs help emotionally and needs counseling or some kind of mental struggles that they might be having. But then, of course, we would say the spiritual issues. I think we see clearly that Jesus speaks of this in Mark, in chapter 2 of Mark, when he is healing the paralytic. I love this passage. It reads, "And immediately Jesus, perceiving in his spirit that they thus questioned within themselves, and said to them, 'Why do you question these things in your hearts? Which is easier, to say to the paralytic, your sins are forgiven, or to say, rise up or take up your bed and walk? But that you may know that the Son of Man has authority on earth to forgive sins,' he said to the paralytic, 'I say to you, rise, pick up your bed, and go home.'" This is a beautiful passage. And right here in this passage, he is not only healing the paralytic spiritual issue, which is he's a sinner and he's in need of forgiveness and need to be right with God, but that is affecting his emotional state. You can't, if you're not at peace with God, how can you emotionally be okay? So that's a huge problem. And then he's not only going to do that, but he's going to heal his physical state. And he's showing all the people that are in the audience at this time or that are present at this time, that he not only has the ability to heal somebody through forgiveness, but he is going to heal him through a physical way as well, because he's a paralytic. And he jumps up and he gets all excited, and it's almost as if he's been emotionally healed, mentally healed, physically healed, and of course we'd say spiritually, because his sins are forgiven. I love this passage because it shows the power of Jesus Christ to do all these things in that very moment. Wonderful. Now, there are many common misconceptions of humanity, which I think are just so vital for us. But there are several misconceptions about humanity. And here are some of those misconceptions. Man is simply a machine or a robot that's just going through the motions. There is no true value to a person's life. They're just robots, more or less, and there's some beliefs and ideas about that. Humans are just animals. That's all they are. The whole idea they've evolved through a process, maybe, and there's nothing unique about them from the perspective of God and God creating them. No, it's an evolution. It's a process of evolution from being an animal, and that's what they would say there. But of course, we know that that's absolutely wrong. Man is simply a sexual being. This is the whole reason for mankind. This is what be a misconception there. The whole reason for them is to pretty much reproduce and to be driven by this. An economic being, a pawn of the universe is another one. A free being, meaning can do whatever they want, whenever they want. There's no accountability. And a social being, just a part of society. There's social progression, and so this is just an individual part of that. But all of these fall short of explaining really what's going on with a person, a human being. And so this next slide will help us a little bit about this, the Christian view of humanity. A human being is a creature of God made in the image of God. Number one, humans are not the product of evolution, but the result of a conscious, purposeful act by an intelligent, infinite person. Erickson wrote that, of course, focusing on the Lord God Almighty there. Then number two, the image of God is intrinsic and indispensable to humanity. All right, so the whole idea of the image of God is in the inner parts of mankind in general, and solely for mankind. I think that's really wonderful to look at. And then the human also has an eternal dimension to himself or herself, that there is this aspect of eternality, that once a person dies, they change, the Bible says, and they will be raised either to punishment, or they'll be raised to eternal life, but there will be an eternal dimension that they will be a part of, and so there is no going away or existing no longer in the idea of humans. It's an eternal aspect to them that they live forever, and they will always exist after they have been created. So this is the wonderful teaching, the Christian view of humanity, given to us by Erickson, okay? All right, well, that concludes our study about the doctrine of humanity. It's good to be with you today. We'll talk to you soon. God bless you. Bye-bye. This has been a great study. I hope you've really enjoyed it, because whenever we study mankind, we also get a glimpse of God's amazing creativity. When we look at the needs or even the characteristics of humans, and we think about their emotional needs, we think about their physical needs or their spiritual needs, we get a sense of how great God really is. He is above all of his creation, of course, but for him to create humans with an ability or capacity to be able to choose things, to be able to experience things, to have the senses that we have, it is very unique. And so this is a wonderful study for us. I hope you've enjoyed it so far. Look forward to the next couple of lessons. God bless you. Talk to you soon. Bye-bye.